It's Sunday morning, and we are in a study on demons and the insanity of America. There is no such thing as demons. Demons is man's imagination. Demon in the Bible is the word daimonion. D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. There's several words that's connected to that word daimonion. You have the word daimon, D-A-I-M-O-N, and it comes from the root dio. Dio means to distribute fortunes. A fortune was not merely money. The love of money is not merely money. Love of money is the word philogoria. Philogoria, that is the word. Love of money is the root of all evil. Love of money. The root of all evil. But love of money is a construction of philos and augury. A-R-G-U-R-Y. Or A-R-G-U-R-I-A, and it comes from the word phileo. That's where the word philos comes from. It means affection or to like. To like augury, A-R-G-U-R-Y, which means silver or shining. And when you shine, you show all of your, you exude all of this popularity and all this money and all these things and all this stuff and your cars and your houses. You're shining. Well, from augury, we get the word A-R-G-U-E. Argue. A man is arguing with God when he wants to shine above others. The Bible said God resists the proud there in James, the fourth chapter. Resist is the word anti-tasso-mai. Anti-tasso-mai means to wage war with, wage war. And so the Bible says God is at war with those who want to shine above others. Whenever you get lots of things and stuff, the Bible says man is not satisfied with more things and stuff. He's not satisfied with all that he gets. He always wants more there in the book of Ecclesiastes. So we're talking about if loving to shine is the root of all evil, and dio or demon, daimonion, means to distribute fortunes. These are going to be directly related to each other, aren't they? And then you trace back demons. The Bible says in Revelation 17 and 5, this also relates to love of money and distributing fortunes. Because Revelation 17 and 5 says, Babylon was the mother of all harlotry. Harlotry. Harlotry is the word porneia. Porneia is the word idolatry. And idolatry, all of this goes, comes, it's all related. It's all related. Be related to loving money, Babylon. And it'll be related to demon. Idolatry is the word E-I-D-O-L-O-L-A-T-R-E-I-A. Idolatry is a construction of ido, which means to see, and latruo, which means to serve. Means to serve. In fact, that word latruo is used there in John the 16th chapter when the Bible says that the time will come when men kill us They'll think they'll do God service. The word service is a form of latruo. The time will come when the world, when they kill the believer, they'll think they're doing God a favor. Now, all of this comes from Babylon. I go back over here because Babylon is in the early part of the Bible, Genesis 11 and 4. When the Bibles, when they say they found a plain in the land of Shinar, Nimrod did, and he built Babylon, and he said, when he built Babylon, let us make us a name. That is the doctrine of Babylon. Let us make us a Shem. If it was in the Greek, it would let us make us an onoma, because they have the same meaning. Onoma means authority. Shem means authority. Let us make up our own authority. And that will also connect to the love of money, distribute fortunes, or to idolatry, Babylon mothering it all. All of this comes from the same thing. And the demons were invented or created in Babylon. Demons were gods in the ancient world. They were gods. If you went back to the first century and you said something about a demon, they would say, which god are you talking about? Hercules or who? Are you talking about Jupiter? He was a demon. They called all of these gods demon. This is not some opinion. This is out of dozens of books I've got in my library. They will tell you these were gods. Now, we're talking about casting out demons. Babylon is built on self. You're casting out self, and this would tie to Mark, the first chapter, when, and I've said this so many times, if you think you've got it all down, you really don't. I'm having to reconstruct this so I can go into some new things. Now, Mark, the first chapter, there was a man with an unclean spirit, and the same man was said to have an unclean, this is Luke's account, Luke 4 and Mark 1. He was said to have an unclean, D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. Now we're talking about casting out daemonion. What does it mean? It doesn't mean some guy's wallowing on the floor in a church and making all kinds of grunting sounds, going, I've seen that. Has anybody seen that besides me? You never been in a church where they did that? It's really wild. You ought to treat yourself. It's like going to a movie. It's crazy. Somebody's walking on the floor and they're doing like this and making all kinds of sounds and noises, and some guy's down there saying, come out, thou foul spirit! And dumb. I don't know what they're all wasting time. They're wasting TV time, wasting money. It's not true. Now, if you cast out devils, you're casting out a Babylonian attitude. Babylon is called a mountain of pride. Now remember, a mountain was a capital city of an empire. Where do you get that, Jim? You can get that out of any number of books, but particularly McClintock and Strong. Look up Mount. And she's called a mountain of pride. She was founded on self. And she was called a destroying mountain. Now, how's all the world made drunk with the wine of her fornication? When you mix a drunken elixir, was a, in the ancient world, that was an art to make a drunken elixir of some sort. You had to mix a certain amount of water with a certain amount of the grape juice, and you had to put a certain amount of they had it down to a fine art, a certain amount of sugar, had a little bit of sweetness, you know. And and they had to age it at lukewarm temperature, and that would make you drunk. That's why the church at Laodicea, the Bible says, if you're lukewarm, I'll spew you out of my mouth. He's talking about vomiting up a mixed religion. Mixed religion is mixing truth with a lie. So when you're talking about pride or a destroying mountain and a proud mountain, God says, I'm going to make you a burnt mountain. And we find Babylon burning there in Jeremiah, the 51st chapter, Revelation, the 8th chapter, Revelation, the 18th chapter. We find Babylon being destroyed and burning. Old Testament Babylon was destroyed on the Euphrates River and sunk into the river. And everywhere you find a Babylonian system, it always is cast down into the sea. Those swine were not, there wasn't anything but self put into the swine that went off into the sea, because the man there in Luke 8, the Bible says he was possessed with devils. Now, when you look at that, that looks like three words to you and me. In the Greek text, it's not. It's one word. Possessed with devils is another form of daimonion. It is the word daimonizomai. Daimonizomai. Now, when you go into the McClinic and Strong, get the P volume out and look up possessed with devils. It'll be listed under the P section. You look up possessed, and it'll say with devils after that, and it'll tell you it's one word. And they will tell you possessed with devils meant to be insane. And the man was said to be possessed with devils in Luke 8. He was said to be insane. And then the Bible says when self was cast into these swine, the man came to his right mind. When it says right mind, the word is sophroneo. Sophroneo means sane. Now, I've been talking about America is insane. That guy had to be nuts, because when you look at him over there in the 5th chapter of Mark, he's running through the tombs, cutting himself all over, bleeding all over the place. He's trying to communicate with these, with his ancestors who are supposed to be in these swine. Stop and look at this. Just stop and look at it. Here's this guy, cutting myself all over. And all of a sudden, Jesus walks up and said, he didn't say, what is your name? He said, what to you is this outside of you? He couldn't have been saying, what is your name? For the fact that your is second person. When you look up in an interlinear Bible, if you know just a little bit about English, and it will tell you, it is the way they construct the Greek language is not the way we construct language. People ask me, do you speak Greek? I'll say, not the ancient Greek, that's a dead language. They constructed their language in a very strange manner to us, but not to them. If they had an adjective which modifies nouns and pronouns, we always put our adjectives right before the noun that it modifies. Blue bird. Blue would be what kind of a bird it is. It is an adjective. Blue bird. But they might put bird over the barn flew blue. I'm just saying that would be something similar to what they would do. So you cannot go by, you have to look these words up. When you look up what they translated, these were, you say, are you smarter than the guys that translated the New Testament? Let me put it this way, I'm a whole lot more objective. I find all kinds of mistakes in the translation. I find them where they translate, take a possessive pronoun, or take a definite article, the, and translate it to a possessive pronoun like his. You got that all through the King James Bible. So you'd have to go back and find out what it meant. What the interlinear Bible says, it says, what to you is their authority. He's talking about this thing that you think you've got in you. If a guy's going, cut, slash, I'm bleeding everywhere, I'm going to talk to my ancestors, and Jesus asks him some question like this, you actually believe Jesus knows what he's talking about when he answers, I got legion in me. I got legion. I got 3,000 to 6,000 demons in me, and they're feminine. And Jesus is going to believe anything he says. No way you're going to believe a nut. And the Bible says he was insane. But so is America. America, I'm going to read these definitions to you again. When you get into, I went into the Webster's Dictionary, and I went into insanity. I looked up insanity. All right, the state of being insane, mental illness, derangement. So what I did, I went and looked up the word derange. It means to upset the arrangement or order. Upset order. Now we've talked about an orderly arrangement. And if men would look these words up, that find out God does not love everybody. For God, here's what makes America insane. Insane means to mess up the arrangement. And the word cosmos in John 3:16 is the word world. It don't mean the dirt or the globe we're on. It doesn't mean any of that. It means an orderly arrangement. Orderly arrangement. And it is masculine gender. Now, I'm going to say this real slow so you'll remember it. It means if you go into a Strong's Concordance, this is the word they'll give you, cosmos. But if you go into looking at the, you have masculine, feminine, neuter gender. Masculine, feminine, neuter gender. In the singular and in the plural, you got the cases. You have nominative, genitive, dative, and accusative case. You say, Jim, I don't understand that. Well, you can if you know what the subject of the sentence is or the predicate nominative. Predicate nominative is something always has to have a being verb. The or Jim, and make it easy. Jim is the pastor. If you're going to diagram the sentence, Jim is pastor. And the modifying verbs go under there, the. Well, pastor in a predicate nominative, pastor in the predicate, which is the last half of the sentence, all this is in the predicate, the pastor and Jim are the same thing. Pastor is a predicate nominative. It's in the predicate what's equal to the subject. If you have a direct object, you got Jim through the ball. You always got an action verb because if you have a direct object, that receives the action of the verb. So if you remember that, you know a couple of major points of English. Well, the subject and the predicate nominative is the nominative case. And you got six ways to spell it. Then the genitive case is shows possession, baptism of repentance. Just the fact that you go to the genitive case and you look, if it says baptism of repentance, which it nearly every time says it, that means true baptism belongs to repentance. Repentance owns true baptism. So repentance, that eliminates, the genitive case eliminates baptism from being water, because true baptism belongs to repentance. Repentance is being turned and thinking differently, and a blood baptism was a death. But how are you going to know that if you say, well, I'm a Baptist and my preacher says it's dipping in water? We're crazy down there because we don't believe in definitions, or we don't believe in culture of 4,000 years, 2,000 years ago, because we live in the 21st century. We don't live 2,000 years ago. That's insane. That's insanity. They're deranged. And when anybody you talk to will say, well, God loves everybody. John 3:16 says, I don't care what it says over in Romans 9. God loving Jacob, hating Esau. They think they can just pull anything out of the Bible they want to. This is insanity. Insanity means unsound or irrational. Well, that's your verse over here in Romans 9. I got my verse over here in Romans 8, 29. And my verse is over here in John 3:16. God loves everybody. If you tell them, it doesn't say that. It's insane to take and ignore definitions, to ignore parts of speech. The very word that shows that God does not love everybody is right there at the beginning of John 3:16. For God so loved. So is an adverb. You can't just, I got a t-shirt. Says on the back of it, John 3:16, so is an adverb. I've never had anybody ask me what that means. I think that's funny. So is an adverb. Adverbs modify. They alter. Alter verbs, adjectives, other adverbs. The word so modifies or it alters love. Love is a conditional word there because you got the adverb so. If you ignore so, you're irrational, you're insane. You can't just come up and say, well, I think because my preacher said we need to be dipped in water, if there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, there in Ephesians 4 and 5, you're going to have to ignore the date that Paul wrote the book of Ephesians. Ignore it. Because he wrote it somewhere about 50 to 55 A.D. He wrote it somewhere about there. Well, wasn't that after Jesus was nailed to the cross? About 30, 25 years after? Well, if it was after he was nailed to the cross, when he was nailed to the cross, all the ordinances of the Old Testament were blotted out. They were nailed to the cross. And if you ignore what does that mean in Colossians 2:14, you're insane. You can't just say it don't matter what blotting out the handwriting of ordinances, which is contrary to us, took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. You better find out what nailed to a cross means. You need to find out what it means to drive a nail through an official document in the first century. It meant to invalidate that law. He said all the rituals of the law are invalidated. We don't dip people in water here. We ain't going to sprinkle them with water. If you ignore the definition of the word baptize, you are insane. You can go to the best scholars in the land. Mr. Strong here. If you ignore that, you're out of your mind. And he says the same thing as Robert Girdlestone says. He says, baptize was a verbal noun. Well, knowing a little bit about English, not a lot, I know a verbal noun is an infinitive. I know what an infinitive is. An infinitive is a noun. A noun is a person, place, or thing. And you got pronouns that take the place of nouns, like he or his, instead of saying Jim or the building, it. If you ignore the fact that these are, that baptize was a noun, not a verb originally. That's what Mr. Strong says, Mr. Girdlestone says. They say it, an infinitive is where a fluid from an outer source covers something. And concerning baptize, if you ignore, baptize comes from two words, B-A-P-T-I-Z-O and babto. Baptizo means to cover. Notice, to cover, not to dip. It means to take a fluid and to cover something all over. If you baptize a barn, you don't pick it up and dip it in paint, do you? You splash the paint up on the barn. That would be a form of that. When Peter is at the house of Cornelius, and he commanded them to be baptized in the name. Acts 10:48. If he commands them to be baptized in the Greek text is an infinitive. In, and the word in, E-N, or we'd say E-N, when used with an infinitive, means with or by. And that's all. It cannot mean into water because it is a word, this word, and Mr. Strong will tell you that. Just look up baptize. And he'll say it means with or by. Be baptized with the name. And what is God's name? Onoma is the word name. It means authority. Authority. And God's authority is His Word. And Thy Word is truth, and the Holy Spirit is truth. So the Word of God is the truth. So you're baptized with God's truth, with the Word is truth, the Holy Spirit is truth. Therefore, the Holy Spirit and the Word are the same thing. And that's God's authority. But if you ignore these, if you ignore all of these parts of speech, what have we got with the English Bible? We have a confusion of languages. Do I, and people call me crazy, and they're crazy. The world will say, that Jim Brown's a cult. No, you're an idiot. I'm giving you an adverb and an adjective and a noun and telling you what an infinitive is, and you're calling me crazy? And you say it don't matter if it's an infinitive or a verb. You don't ever know how much you're going to need this stuff. And I'm not giving you advanced college English. I'm giving you 9th and 10th and 11th grade English. That's all I ever took. But I remembered a whole bunch of it. So if you ignore this, this means with or by. Don't matter whether anybody believes it or not. That's like saying the interlinear Bible is a lie. Interlinear has got the, it has the authorized version or the Textus Receptus on the top line, the English. Then it's got, the Greek on the top line. It's got English under it. And I don't even trust the English in an interlinear Bible. I take the word, pull it out, look at the context. Go to my English, I go to my Greek definitions, look at the parts of speech, see what part of speech it is, and see what it's doing. Do I expect America to do that? Never. Never, 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 never. Preachers are not going to do that, are they? We're just in trouble. What you're going to have to do is come here to learn this. If I knew there was someplace else over across the country that was talking about parts of speech, I'd say, well, you go over there. I have people all the time, where am I going to go in New York? I don't have any idea. Go to John New Rowers. He has a class in his house. But I don't know where to go in Oklahoma. And we're on TV out in Oklahoma, down in Texas. I have people call me, what am I going to do? Believe God for one thing. If someone says, the Bible says, whosoever will may come. It does not, you're an ignoramus if you say that. Doesn't say anywhere, whosoever will may come. The Bible does say over there in the 22nd chapter of Revelation, whosoever will, let him take. But there's no such thing, there's no such word as whosoever in the Greek language. It's not there. It doesn't say whosoever will may come. It says whosoever will, but it says in the Greek text, the willing. Take. It says the willing, but who's going to have the will? And if you don't balance this with the rest of the Bible, you're insane. The Bible says none is willing. Well, where are they going to get this will? Psalms 110:3, thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power. If you cannot correlate words over here and you say, well, God's not willing that any should perish. Yes, he is. It doesn't say that in the Greek text. How in the world, I look at the people here and my heart goes out to you because I know most of you don't know this much English, and this is not advanced English. It's very elementary. It's very, very high school English is what it is.
Sixth grade.
Huh?
Sixth grade.
It's what?
Sixth grade.
Sixth grade. Thank you, Eric. Not hard. Maybe infinitives are not in the sixth grade, but nouns and pronouns and verbs and adjectives are. And if you don't find out what so means, he so loved. They'll say, well, see, God couldn't love Jacob and hate Esau because he loves all the world. If you think that way, you're insane. What makes you insane is the way you look at the world. You usually are looking at it because you don't want to mess up your feather bed with your family, with your friends. I believe a lot of people leave here, and they leave because they say, I'll never get to where Jim is. Well, you're not supposed to get to where I am. You're supposed to be where God wants you to be. But you keep listening to the truth, you keep learning it, and you use it, you're not going to get where I am. I've been studying for 60 years. You're not supposed to be where I am. You're supposed to be where God wants you. Now, I can't even say everything I want to say. They'll say, well, that's your verse over here in Romans 9, God, when Rebekah had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God, according to election, might stand, not of works, but him that calleth. It was said unto Rebekah the elder, Esau will serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. For either one were born, for they were while they were still in the womb, God loved Jacob and hated Esau. Now let me amalgamate. If you can't take two verses that appear contradictory to one another, Romans, the 8th chapter, and John 3:16 to the world, that seems to contradict, doesn't it? God loved Jacob and hated Esau, for God so loved the world. I heard John MacArthur say one time, he said, how can God love Jacob and hate Esau? Then he referred to John 3:16 and said, and how can he love all the world at the same time? I thought, John, you're smarter than that. And he said the answer to that, how can God love Jacob and hate Esau? Romans 8, starting in verse 11 down to verse 13. And how can that fit with John 3:16? 3:16. Well, it works by so. So being an adverb, it alters loved. And loved is very interesting. That's the word agape. If it's a verb, like loved, it's agapao. Word endings are changed depending on the character of the word. This is a noun. This is a verb. For God so loved. Well, what we got to do, since so puts a condition on loved, puts a condition, what is loved? Well, the Bible says this is love, this is agape, that we walk after His commandments. After God's commandments. Well, here's how you amalgamate Romans 8.
Romans 9.
Oh, excuse me. Where did I get that? Romans 9. Romans 9. I was going to put Romans 8:29. Whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate, and so forth. Well, here's how you amalgamate these two. You define loved, and Jacob have I loved. Here's the way you do it. You define loved over here, it's the same word as over here. Same word, Jacob have I loved. The reason God so loved, because He didn't love everybody. He hated Esau before he's born. So whatever loved is, hated Esau would be the exact opposite, wouldn't it? I'm trying to make this very elementary. Loved is agape, or the verb form of agape, and that's walking in the commandments of God, walk in commandments. Well, in the Old Testament, who got the commandments of God? Who got the commandments?
Israel.
Who else got the commandments of God? Nobody. Did Esau get some of God's commandments? Jacob's older brother, he was the twin, the first twin that come out of the womb. Esau didn't get any of God's commandments. They went to Israel, and Jacob's name was changed to Israel in the 32nd chapter of Genesis. So we can substitute. If Jacob equals Israel, let's get right down into some algebra, first week of algebra, okay? You're going to high school, and you're in the 10th grade, and you're going to algebra class. Here's one of the first things the teacher will tell you. Equals that are substituted for equals. Equals substituted. The results are equal. Substituted. I'll get it right. Now, if you substitute Israel, since it's equal to Jacob, let's do it this way. Israel have I loved, and loved is walking in the commandments of God, so let's substitute walking in the commandments for loved. Israel have I given my commandments. Wouldn't that work? Now, that's an easy way to say that. But if you ignore that by saying, well, God loved everybody, and besides that, He's not willing that any should perish. I've heard supposed to be intelligent preachers like Jerry Falwell. God's going to save the world. We're out to see if we can save the world for Christ. He's dead, but boy, he was stupid. How can you save all the world for Christ when He doesn't love everybody, and most of the world is going to hell because they're vessels of wrath fitted to destruction? Few are going to enter into the... See, that fits in few and many. The many are going to destruction, or into the wide gate and the broad way. The wide gate and the broad way, and few are going into the narrow gate and the narrow way and the straight gate. Few. Whenever I say the few is Israel, God's predestinated elect, and we're spiritual Israel, if you ignore that, you're insane. You can't just say, well, my Baptist preacher says, I don't care what your Baptist preacher says, I was a Baptist preacher one time, once upon a time. What does that mean? Nothing. But most people do not have enough confidence in their own ability to think, because our whole society is insane. I don't believe anything anybody says unless I can see it and figure it out. Just somebody saying something, it may be true, but it may not be true. Evaluate everything you hear. If we're at the end of time, for some reason, people ignore these verses. If you ignore that 2 plus 2 is 4, and you ignore mathematics, somebody just give you a check, and it could be half a check or half of what you work for, and you're so dumb you don't know any difference. I don't think you're that stupid, are you? It shows that the world, people say, you shouldn't call people stupid. Well, the word is ba'ar in the Hebrew. The word is alogos in the Greek. Alogos, this is the alpha privative of the alogos. It comes from logos, which is the word. It's God's word. Placing the alpha in front of logos, it negates the word, gives an opposite meaning. It means no word of God. That is the word stupid, or in both Hebrew and Greek, duh or dull of hearing. And then you got to fit in that with faith cometh by hearing, and hear and obey are the same word. And the hearing ear and the seeing eye, the Lord hath made even both of them. You've got to learn proof scripture with scripture and tie them together and define the words and get the parts of speech. And if you just say, well, I know what I feel. I know that I've spoken tongues. No, you have not. You're involved in an emotionalism in your so-called church. It's not a church if they don't tell the truth. Is it? For some reason, some people think, well, they talk about Jesus, and I like to get together with them, and they talk about free will, and they really believe in that, and I believe in predestination, but they're good Christians too, and I'm a good Christian too. If they don't believe in predestination, everything in their belief is askew. It's twisted. It's distorted. Everything you can think of has to do with the sovereignty of God. That means God is over all. He's Lord over everything, including the good and the evil. And if you don't believe God creates evil, take your concordance and look up the word evil, and look how many times in the Old Testament the Bible is speaking of God creating evil. If you ignore that, we're living in some really bad times. They're passing laws right and left against the laws of God. I mean, this thing of letting women and men go in the same restroom, you know what that's going to provoke in America? A lot of rapes. What it's going to cause. And how these people can be that insane, that's without any rational reasoning. America's as crazy as it can be. I asked my doctor the other day. He walked in, how you doing, Jim? He has this high respect for me because I get to talk to him about biblical history and he don't even know where I am in it. And I said, Doc, do you know that America is crazy? He said, yes, I know that. You see, doctors won't agree with you because doctors have got a lot of things together and they don't want to lose their money and they don't want to lose their position and they like what they've got. But he stood there and said, yes, they're crazy. He said, we are going to collapse and go down. I said, thank you. I said, you do know that every man, woman, and child in America owes $43,000 apiece. I said, how's that ever going to be paid? That ain't never going to be paid. And that is if we actually owe $13 trillion, live over $13 trillion. But some of the economists say we owe $18.5 trillion. Some say up to $20 trillion. America's insane if they think this is not going to fall. I used to sell houses years ago. And the reason most young couples could not qualify for a house is because they had 15 credit cards. They would take 8 credit cards and pay the interest on the 7 credit cards 1 month, and take these credit cards and pay the interest on these credit cards 1 month, the next month, and I'd say, you know you're going to fall, don't you? You can't keep living this way. Neither can America. I think America is just berserk. But they don't look like it. How many of y'all think people are as nice as their smiles out in public? You actually be there that nice behind the scene? No, they're cheating and lying, stealing, hooking one another and trying to clip each other.
They're out to get you.
Huh? They're not so much out to get you. They're out to get ahead, and if you're in their way, they'll step on you while they're on the way up. They're out to get anybody who gets in their way of their success. America's, they're crazy. Let me read a few more of these definitions. Insane. Extreme senselessness. Do I expect America to come around because I preach this message and give you parts of speech? No. I expect God's people to congregate together and try to learn together. And it don't matter how many people go away. I believe because I've been accused of using too much extracurricular, extra-biblical knowledge. If I don't go into extra-biblical knowledge, you're not going to know anything about adjectives and adverbs and infinitives and participles. But if you don't know any, you're not going to know what in the world is going on. And like the old saying, ignorance is bliss. If ignorance is bliss, America is the world's biggest blister. Aren't they? It's crazy. Sometimes I wonder, what in the world is wrong with me? And then I go home, read my Bible, and ain't nothing wrong with me. Something's wrong with the world, isn't it? Listen to the word crazy. Crazy. Unsound mind. Unsound. What is the word sound in the Bible? H-U-G-I-A-I-N-O. Hugiano means uncorrupt. Oh, by the way, when you keep looking up these definitions about insane, it will say corrupt. Corrupt mind. Corrupt thinking, and it will tell you what causes you to have the corrupted thinking and to be crazy. You don't have to be in an institution out here to be crazy. All you got to do is ignore reasoning. They'll tell you that insane means to be unreasonable, not to be able to assimilate the facts. Look over here in 1 Timothy. It means not to be sound in your thinking. 2 Timothy 1. And if you can't be sound in your thinking, you're crazy. If you have to go, you know what you have to go against? Self over here in Babylon. You have to go against your very nature to say, I'm going to face the truth. I don't care what it is. Now, I've been that way since I was a kid. I wanted the truth at any cost. That's why I never got along with anybody. I never got along with the other kids in school. I told you before, in my mid-20s, 26, 28, I became a basket case. I was trying to figure out the world and how to get along with them. I shook all the time and Sometimes I do now, but I think that's age, and it's not. I was a nervous wreck back then. I was taking just tons of Valium and all kinds of medication, and I went down to Texas to talk to Herbert Clark. He's a guy I went to high school with. I just wanted to talk to him because I knew him better than anybody else, and I sat down in a room with him. I said, "Herbert, I come to talk to you. I drove 750 miles or 800 just to talk to you." I said, "I can't get along with anybody. I feel crazy." And he looked at me and said, "Jimmy, you ain't never got along with anybody." I said, "What?" He said, "You never have got along with anybody." He said, "We'd be standing out in front of Beaumont High School, and it looked like that school in Greece. What was the name of it? Rydell Iyer, named after Bobby Rydell. And we'd be standing out there," and he said, "You'd walk up and just drop, boom, bombs on us." Now, I couldn't have been real smart back then, but if somebody said something, I'd just go blurt it out. He said, "You always just drop the truth on us, and we're all playing games." I said, "Well, I didn't know that. Why didn't you tell me that?" I found out I was trying to get along with a world that I wasn't supposed to be getting along with. If you're friends with the world, you're an enemy of God. I found out I never had close friends. I never ran around with anybody in school. I drove around in my old 49 Chevrolet with a hole in the floorboard, water splashing up on me on days it rained. I could not figure out how to live with people. When God dealt with me back in my mid-40s and I started this class, all of a sudden, the people who were like me started coming towards this truth. I never had a close friend in my life. Never ran around with anybody. Didn't go to any football games. Absolutely didn't go to any dances. My father would have killed us for that. And I couldn't figure out, why can't I get along? Has anybody felt that way in your life? That's the elect. They always feel like that. It's because we're not crazy and we think there's something wrong with us and there's something wrong with the world. It's self. It's sin. Now look here. Look here in 2 Timothy 1. 2 Timothy 1 and 13. "Hold fast the form of sound words. Do not be insane. Do not twist things." This is going to fit with all those perverting scriptures that the Pharisees were doing that I've been talking about on Sunday night. "Sound is the word hugiano, which thou hast heard of me in faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. That good things which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost, which dwelleth in us." That's Christ in you, isn't it? Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's the kingdom of God that's in you. Now look over here at 2 Timothy. This is where we are today. 2 Timothy 4, verse 1. "I charge thee therefore before God." Now who's he talking to? Who's Paul talking to? He's talking to Timothy, and Timothy, remember, 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus are called the pastoral epistles. That's because Timothy was pastoring a church here at Ephesus. Now, this is Turkey right here. Right here on the southwestern end of Turkey, it was called Asia Minor back then, see, Asia. He was pastoring a church here. And Titus was pastoring a church here at Crete. So he's talking to two preachers about sound doctrine. Don't preach anything that's unsound, that's unreasonable, that can't be rationalized by the word, by the parts of speech, by the culture, the customs, the idioms, the metaphors, the definitions. Don't preach anything that's not exactly correct. Then he says, here in, "I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word, be instant, in season, eukaros, well-timed, E-U-K-A-R-O-S. Kairos means a timing, you means a good timing, when it's a good time to preach. Be instant, in season and out of season. Ikaros. When it's convenient, convenient, and when it's not convenient. And I've talked to people, they say, well, I can't talk to my family, it's not the right time. Paul is saying, preach to people the truth, preach sound doctrine when the time is good and when it's not good. I've had people say, well, I can't talk to people at this church over here on the front steps of the church. That's the place to talk to them. In season and out of season, when it's convenient and when it's not convenient. Reprove, elango, means to convict a person. Reprove, rebuke, epitomeo. Epitomeo comes from the word timae. Timae is the same word, honor your father and mother. That means to give them what of value. That would be the truth, wouldn't it? Epi means to superimpose with the valuable things of God. Preach the word, be instant in seat, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine, didache. Instruction. Don't give somebody twisted instruction. Don't say God loves everybody. John 3:16 says so. I've got a shirt that says, John 3:16 is predestination. And people will say, John 3:16, oh, I like your shirt. I say, did you see what it said? Is predestination. Oh, because it is. It doesn't say in John 3:16, whosoever believeth in him. It doesn't say that in the original text. It says that instead of whosoever believeth in him, this is what it says in the original text. That the believing all shall have everlasting life. The is singular, masculine, gender. Believing is a participle, which is also an adjective. It's an ing word used as an adjective. It has a verbal character to it. And these both modify all. And always the modifying words have to carry the same gender, the same number, and these are all singular. Singular, singular, masculine, gender. There is one believing all, and that means the all that the Father giveth me shall come to me. John 6:37. So there's one all, that's the church, that's the flock, that's the wife, that's the bride, and it's composed of everyone that's in the church, but who cares? Huh? I care. I want to know what the exact truth is. I don't want to be insane like the world. These preachers up and down this street, they're crazy. You can tell them the truth. Well, that's your opinion. That's the way you see things, and we see these things different at my church. No, you're. Next time somebody says it, just say, you're crazy, you know it. Walk away. And say, I'm not joking with you. This is not a figure of speech. Whenever I say the church is insane, I'm not using a figure of speech. They can't assimilate any facts, can they? Then he goes on to say, for the time will come when they will not endure. The word endure, anekomai, means to put up with. A-N-E-C-H-O-M-A-I. Comes from Anna and Echo. Echo means to hold up or to put up. It means to, they will not put up with uncorrupt words. They will not put up with uncorrupt instruction. Corrupt instruction means you're crazy. America's crazy, and that's, you know what makes them crazy? All this stuff they can live for, all the things, and they have inserted, in fact, if you go back over here to 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter, here's what they put into the church today. Here's what they've done. In verse 3, he's talking about not blaspheming the word of God. In verse 2, blaspheme, blasphemos, is a construction of the word blapto and phime. Blapto means to hinder. You don't have any preachers I've heard say, we don't know what blasphemy of the Spirit is. First of all, the Holy Spirit's truth. Thy word is truth. So, Holy Spirit and the Word of God are truth. Truth, aletheia, means to take off the cover. Like what I'm doing up here. I'm taking off the cover of all these words. And phime is our word fame. Phime means to hinder the fame of God. And phime, we get the word phime. And phime means words that are spoken or said. It means to hinder God's word that has been spoken by Him. And they're talking about if you hinder God's words, then you're crazy, aren't you? You can't rationalize His words. And then he goes on here to verse 3. If any man teach otherwise, he's crazy. Teach otherwise is one word, heterodiskaleo, didaskaleo. Hetero, heterodiskaleo. It comes from didaskalia, didaskalia, which is the word instruction. Instruction, you can't say, well, I got a Jesus, and it don't say, and my Jesus is not like yours. What you have is another Jesus. Well, I just think it's okay to speak in tongues, and I think it's not. I have people write to me, I believe in tongues. I like what you're teaching, but I believe in tongues. What you're doing is false. I can take all day long and talk about tongues, all day, and give you one definition after another. Is that going to change your mind? Probably not, because you know what you feel. You say, Jim, that sounds like an insult. It is, just like Elijah insulted the priest of Baal when he jumped up and down on the altar of God all day long, breaking it down, cutting himself, bleeding all over the place. They were crazy like that man of the Gadarenes. And Elijah stood over there and said, maybe your God is asleep. If you'll yell real loud, maybe you can wake him up. I know what it is. He's on a journey, and he can't hear you. They're going, ah, and just cutting themselves all over. And he says, perhaps he's on a journey. I won't insult these guys for lying about the God's word that I serve. I love this book. I don't care who likes it and who don't like it. And I watch preachers all the time, and they all sound stupid. Stupid means you cannot hear. You have the understanding of a brute beast, and you can't hear. But most of the world can't hear because God hasn't given them ears to hear. And hear and obey the same word. Faith cometh by hearing. Now, look here. This man preaches any other doctrine, he's crazy if he's got a Bible. He's proud, knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy and strife and railing and evil surmisings. Perverse, they're perverted. They're twisted in their preaching. And men of corrupt minds. Now you can tie this word corrupt with other doctrines, which is insane, with no rational ability. And this word corrupt, that's one of the definitions. That's one of the definitions of insane. Of corrupt minds. The word corrupt, diaphthero. D-I-A-P-H-T-H-E-I-R-O. Phthero means a corrupt mind. Dia, this means thoroughly rotten. Their thinking is stinks in God's nostrils, the way they think. Well, they haven't repented. Repent. Metanoia. You say, Jim, do I have to study all those Greek words? Well, no, but you will know the truth. You'll know it in your heart. You'll know if something's wrong. And if you talk to an elect, they'll know when it's wrong too. Without explaining all these words, you'll say, I just don't believe in tongues. I don't think it's right. If you say that much, and the person you're talking to is elect, they'll say, I've been wondering about that myself. God's already written his words upon the heart of his family. Metanoia means to be turned and think differently. If you think after the flesh, if you think because somebody talks about Jesus that you have a right to fellowship with them, and they, if someone is off on predestination and they believe in free will, they also celebrate Christmas. You know that, don't you? They also celebrate Easter. They also don't believe in a daily cross or self-denial or death to self. They certainly do not believe in being hated by the world, even though Jesus said, if the world hate me, it will hate you. Did they hate him? Well, enough to kill him. That's pretty bad hatred, isn't it? You try to quote, I have never heard a preacher read the 15th chapter of John, starting in verse 18. Never heard the next 3 to 4 verses read there. If the world hate me, it'll hate you. If it persecuted me, it'll persecute you. If you are of the world would love his own. But you're not of the world, therefore the world hates you. He said they have to be hating you. It's crazy to say that you don't have to go through tribulation and persecution. That's insane. The Bible says, I had a person write me, said, you don't have to have a daily cross to go to heaven. The Bible says, he that beareth not his cross and followeth after me, in Luke 14:27, you cannot be my disciple. Jesus said, besides, what goes with that is Luke 9:23. Now, Luke 14:27 says, you cannot be a disciple without a daily cross. It doesn't say daily in that verse, but it says daily in Luke 9:23. Don't you have something called a precedent? A precedent says if something's said once, it applies everywhere it says it. So if it just says cross somewhere, and it says it bunches of places, if it just says cross in Luke 14:27, and over in Philippians, the third chapter, men hate, he said, men at Philippi hate the cross of Christ. And here's the reason. Because there God is their belly. Now, if you don't know that belly was an Epicurean term, what are you going to know to do with that? The Epicurean said the only thing, the only God a man needed was his belly, and whatever it took to fill up your belly, belly to them was all the spiritual needs they had, whether it was food, whether it was a new cart, a new ox, or whatever. You could translate that to our day and time. My belly is my car, my house, my job, my IRA. That's my belly. That's the way you could translate it. Well, if your belly was the world things of this world, well, their God is their belly, and the reason their God is their belly is because their mind, sophroneo, their sentiment, their love and desire is on earthly things. We're back to where we started. The God is self, aren't we? Let us make us a name. Their God is their belly because their mind, their thinking is on earthly things. And I love the word earthly. Boy, that word picks it up and hits the road with it. Earthly, gay, is the word soil or dirt. The reason men don't like this daily cross in these churches is because they like dirt. And everything you see is dirt. You're dirt. I'm dirt. These tables are dirt. Your car is dirt. Your house is dirt. Some good-looking woman that a guy will see, she's just dirt. Wait till she's dead for 10 years. You won't think she's that pretty. I promise you. Will you? Wait till your car is rotten and is rusted out, and it's 100 years from now, if the Lord doesn't come, which he will, at least he'll come for me. Nothing is what it looks like. It's just a bunch of dirt. And that's what keeps men from the daily cross. But if you belong to God, when he said in Luke 9:23, if you don't pay any attention to this, if any man comes after me, if is not in the text, any man after me, let him deny self, take up cross. And follow me. Take up cross daily. So wherever you find a daily cross, God's going to have to deal with you, because take, deny, and follow are all imperative moods in the Greek. An imperative is a command, but God is not commanding anyone who doesn't have ears to hear. When he says, he that hath an ear to hear, let him hear. That's third person singular, and it's an imperative mood. Let him hear. And the hearing ear, the seeing eye of the Lord hath made even both of them. If you don't connect these verses together, you can watch my DVDs and get an education in the truth. I would be foolish to say, well, I don't know if you can learn much about that. You might have been studying all these years, and I don't know what I'm teaching. I know exactly what I'm teaching. I have all the confidence in the world to stand up to Billy Graham and say, Mr. Graham, I'm not calling you brother, because I don't know what you are. But you need to repent of sin, because if you don't, you will be in hell with a whole bunch of Baptist preachers. I would tell him that as sure as I'm standing here. And we're on TV over in North Carolina. Maybe he'll hear about us or see us or something. But Mr. Graham, if you don't repent of all these lies you're telling, accept Christ as a lie, Billy, you're crazy. If you think that's the method of salvation, the Bible doesn't teach a sinner's prayer anywhere. Will you pray to God as a sinner? Yes. But when? Before or after you believe? How are you going to start praying to a God you don't believe in? Romans 10:14 says that. How shall they call on him in whom they've not believed? Believe is the method of salvation. Every Baptist preacher in America is preaching accept Christ. And the Bible says you can't do that. You're crazy, mister. If you say that sinner's prayer or accept Christ is the method of salvation, you're insane. If you've ever read the Bible at all. Paul told the Philippians there, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Bet you didn't know believe is a verb, an action verb, did you? I never heard a preacher say that. An action verb shows action. Believing is doing. Believe is the verb form of faith. Believe is the word pistuo. Faith is the word pistis. How do you like that? Do I believe I'm going to do any good with these people? No. I'll tell you what I am doing. I'm preaching judgment to them. And they are afraid of me in this town. Most people know who I am at the grocery store. A lot of them know me down at the department store. They give me this goofy look like, I know you, and I don't know whether to smile or not, because you look awful mean on TV. They do that. It's like a, stop that. How you doing? I just walk up to people and say, hey, what's going on? I don't jump anybody out in public. It's sad for me to see so many people so ignorant. But take, deny, and follow. Deny, aporneomai. It means to utterly contradict self. Take, A-I-R-O, arrow, means to lift up in the air. We probably get the word A-R-R-O-W from that. And follow, akulatheo. Akulatheo means to be in the same way with. There's only one way, it's the narrow way. And that is a command, and narrow, thalibo, comes from the word thalipsis. And thalipsis is the common word tribulation. We must, through much tribulation, enter the kingdom of God. I've written these things on the board, and it's frustrating. The only people who are going to believe this are the elect of God. And we are in a time where people don't believe nothing. How much time do I have, Mike?
17.
Let me give you a couple more of these on... Gosh. Look over here in 2 Timothy. No, we'd already read that. Titus 1. Now, Titus needs to be instructed in sound doctrine. Titus 1. Let me see here. Yeah, Titus 1, verse 9. Remember, Titus is a pastor. I've had people say, pastors, somebody told one of the guys that comes here, one ex-member that was disenchanted, said, pulpit is a Roman Catholic term. It is, duh. It's funny what people will say when they're mad at me because they don't like all this definition. They don't like this extra biblical material. That's because you like to say dumb. You like to say stay stupid. Look here, it's making a statement, pulpit is a Roman Catholic word. You're an idiot, mister. Over here in Nehemiah, the eighth chapter of Nehemiah. Nehemiah and Ezra were pals. They lived at the same time. Golly. Ezra the priest, in verse 2, brought the law before the congregation. Both Ezra was a descendant of Aaron, the high priest. That's why he's going to read the law. Both men and women, and all that could hear with understanding, upon the first day of the seventh month, he read therein before the street that was before the Watergate. From, you thought Watergate was a Washington term, didn't you? All the gates of the city had something they sold at the gates. They had a sheep gate. They had a fish gate. They had a dung gate so that farmers could buy dung there. And they had a water gate. From the morning until midday, before the men and the women and those that could understand, and the ears of the people were attentive, and Ezra the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood, a Roman Catholic pulpit. Why do you people say stuff you don't know nothing about what you're talking about? If you get mad at me, call me names and spit on me. In fact, when I get on my deathbed, I'm going to have Mary go down and take an ad out in the paper and say, "This is Jim Brown. I'm about to die. If keep up with the death notices, you, if you would like, you can come out and spit on my grave when I'm dead." So some of them hate me that much. You know what they what bothers them? Why do we have to know all that stuff? You don't have to know nothing. Just die and go to hell if you want to. If you go to hell, you're supposed to. You say, "Why are you so nonchalant about it?" I only want what God wants, that's all. Now, where was I?
Titus
1. You're supposed to be a lover of hospitality, verse 8. A lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate. I don't have time to go through all the words. Holding fast the faithful word, hold fast God's word, and as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. The anti-lego is the word gainsayer. Those that want to dispute and refuse and contradict God's word. Sound doctrine is the only way to deal with people. If somebody wants to fight you over predestination, just quote a verse. Whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. I'll tell you what you do. Memorize Romans 8, 29 and 30. And memorize Ephesians 1, 4, 5 and 11. You quote those verses, those five verses to somebody, and you'll see them get crazy. Romans 8, 29 and 30. Whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. Whom he called, them he also justified. Whom he justified, them he also glorified. That's Romans 8, 29 and 30. And then memorize Ephesians 1, 4. He hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ unto himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. And if you can remember how to define adoption, huiothesia comes from huios, H-U-I-O-S, which is the word sons, and T-I-T-H-E-M-I. That's the construction of U-I-O-T-H-E-S-I-A. Huiothesia, and there's an H sound there, the breathing sound, the diacritical mark. Huiothesia means to place sons. Say, so you don't place your own son when you're being adopted. You don't place yourself. God places you as a son. And sons have, and who are the sons of God? Romans 8, 14. Those who do the commandments of God. Memorize some of these verses that I quote. Because if you'll do that, you'll have more answers than anybody's got questions. And memorize that, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ and to himself. And if somebody says, "Why would he do that?" Get that last sentence in that verse, according to the good pleasure of his will. And then give them Ephesians 1:11. We have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who works all things after the counsel of his own will. Memorize these five verses. You'll have more answers for somebody. By the time you get into quoting the second one, they'll walk away. If you give them those five verses. Remember, adoption means to place sons according to his will. Do I have any time?
9 minutes.
9 minutes. All right, let me give you another couple of these. All right.
Titus, you never did go.
Huh?
He did.
He did?
All right. Look here in Titus 2. I gave you 9. Let me give you Titus 1:13. This witness is true. Wherefore rebuke these, what he's talking about, there's mouths. Look here at verse 11. Well, I got to go back to verse 10. For there are many unruly. These people are unruly. And you potoktos, insubordinate. I've had a lot of people leave here because they were not going to be subordinate to the will of God. They don't like a daily cross, debt to self, self-denial, suffering, tribulation. They want to live in the flesh and buy new cars and buy new this and buy new that. And they want to fight me over this, huh?
Don't
want
to follow
a
man.
Huh?
Don't
want
to follow
a
man.
Yeah. They'll say stupid things. They'll say stuff like, well, we don't need to follow a man. Yes, you do. Who told you that? Paul said, be ye followers of me, even as I am of Christ. If I'm following Christ, follow me. You don't know how to talk to people, witness? Follow me around during the day. I'll show you about 4 or 5 times. I'll give away nearly every day 3 to 5 DVDs out in public. And I don't ever offend people, don't jump their case and chew on them. But I am prepared with Bible verses and Greek words. That is not a boast. I'm just prepared. If you study math for 60 years, should you know something about it? Well, I've spent that long studying the Bible. I know more Greek words than most Greek professors. I may not know as many word endings as they know, but I know more words as they're printed in the Bible, as they're translated over, than most Greek teachers. And that's not a boast. If I spent this many years, goodness gracious alive, shouldn't I know a lot of them? I should. Have you ever studied something for a long, long, long time?
You probably got forgot a lot of them too, didn't you?
I forgot a lot of them again because sometimes I will watch an old, old message and I'm thinking, I don't remember even saying that, much less, I don't even remember knowing it. I mean, Ken was a fire inspector on the fire department in Nashville. Do you know anything about it?
I still do.
I'm glad he said I sure do, because he knows a lot about it. Because he did that for years. He studied it. He knows it. You better know what you're talking about when you're talking about something. If you don't, you're going to get somebody in trouble. You might get somebody in hell if they were non-elect, and God put you in their path to lead them away. Now, he says here, all right, it'll stop the gainsayers if you preach sound doctrine, for there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers. Gosh, I don't have time to go into all of this. Matiologos is the word vain talkers. This is amazing. Vain talkers. One of the definitions of insane means senseless. This word vain talker, M-A-T-A-I-O. Matiologos means vain talker or senseless. Has the same exact definition as the word insane in Webster's dictionary. They're senseless. Now, how do you learn that? Well, you just one word at a time. I said this before. You've got something I didn't have. I had to forsake all that I had. I was years and years, decade after decade, deprogramming my computer here, throwing out all the garbage I learned from my father. He didn't teach me this. He didn't teach any truth. He'd get up and read the same 4 or 5 verses every week. I don't mind if you got 500 verses and you read them every week, like what I do. But he'd read the same 4 or 5 verses and shout and tell stories for 45 minutes in a little country congregation. You ever heard anybody like that? Yep. And people are going to think you're crazy, just like Judy thought I was crazy, until she stopped and listened one day. It took some kind of emotional trauma in your life to make you listen, didn't it?
That's right.
And that's what it'll have, that's what it'll take. And then he says, for there are many unruly and senseless talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, and they will be one day by God, who subvert, anastrepho, overthrow whole houses. This is what the preachers in America are doing, teaching things which they ought not for money. I said this to Adrian Rogers when I wrote him a letter, and I said, you got that Ashtaroth, it was a great big Christmas tree in your auditorium. And he started giving me answers back that were completely out of context. I just said, what an idiot. And he was one of the biggest preachers in the Southern Baptist Convention, pastored the second largest church in the Southern Baptist Convention in Memphis, Bellevue Baptist. And I can't even take time to go into what he said. Take me an hour to explain what it meant. He said, you sound like you're judging another man's servant. The Bible tells me to judge righteous judgment, and you're preaching wrong. But finally, I just quit on him. I got his letters. I just thought, what an imbecile. He's supposed to be this highly educated man, and he thinks he can convince people if he'll talk like this. If he'll talk like that, it makes you sound like you're educated. Well, I don't know what these guys are trying to do. And then he says, one of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said, the Christians are always liars, even evil beasts, slow bellies. They're lazy, and they want to fill up their bellies. This witness is true. Wherefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith. Am I rebuking these preachers sharply?
Yes,
I am. Apotomos. Sharply, apo, T-O-M-O-S, apotomos means to cut abruptly. Use great pain as a speech. Don't beat around the bush. Say you guys are lying. And if you're a believer, you better get your heart right. This has nothing to do with numbers. It don't have to do with how big your church is. We got 5,000 on Sunday morning. That's probably a sign that you're going to hell, because many are going into the broad way. And the Bible tells us that if you're friends with the world, you know why the Bible says if you're friends with the world, you're enemy of God? If you can get along with a lot of people in your business and gain their favor, you have to compromise to do that. You have to compromise to be somewhere in the music business, don't you? In order to be a big, successful builder, you got to play games with people up here at the country club. To be a real big, super successful real estate agent and sell, there's one agent here talks about closing out $22 million 1 year, and the next year something the same along that line. No one agent can sell that much houses. You can't even process the contracts. I found out that this person had a whole lot of people working for them inside a real estate office. I know, I sold real estate. I know what it takes to write and process contracts. You can't do it. The whole world is full of the con. You know that? And America is crazy. I was going to get to the word corrupt. What causes men to have corrupt minds. Corrupt thinking. A corrupt mind is insanity. People cannot learn. What keeps them from it is money, things. This nation is built for insanity. It's built for crazy people. You can't have all this successful religion in America and not be out of your mind. Because it's not going to, and people talk about it. Mega churches, you can't preach what I preach and have a mega church. It's not possible. I've run out of time. I'm going to come back and talk about more about insanity. And when demons are cast out, self is cast out, your insanity is cast out, And you got to be bold enough to start saying the truth blunt to your friends. But the reason you won't do it is because you're not founded enough in the Word. And that's the reason I suggested to you to memorize those five verses and certain verses that I'll quote at times about tribulation and persecution. Learn these and give them to people. Just say them to them. Well, let's pray. Father, thank you for truth. God, help us to be strong in the Word. Help the flock. Lord, I don't know what to even do anymore except what I'm doing. I'll just keep doing it. Lord, I pray for the sheep most of all. Strengthen them. God, will praise you for all things, including the evil that comes in our life, because you are conforming us to your likeness and your image. God, help the sheep. Lead us to your elect. Fight all of our battles for us, Lord. We can't. We'll praise you for all things. In Christ's name, amen.
That was great, John.
Well, it's just the truth. And you can't come up and get this one day. You got to take some.
I'm a crazy on booze and drugs when I was on the
road. Yeah.
That's crazy.
I know.
Crazier than a squirrel.
Well, the reason those rock people don't like preachers is because preachers are lying and they recognize it. But they don't know that there's something else to the Bible besides them.
But I found out the hard way.
Huh?
Like you, I found out the hard way.
Yeah.
And it was hard.
Well, it is hard. It is. There's so much to this message.